This is the day the Lord has made. Welcome to worship at historic Franklin Presbyterian Church. Again, a special welcome to all our visitors today. Thank you for joining us for worship of our Lord in spirit and in truth. For members, friends, and visitors alike, please sign the friendship pad near the end of the aisle of each row. Then pass it along to the others worshiping in the pew. If you are new to us and you want us to have your information, please include that as well. We have some special announcements today, and we're going to start with Pam. Pam has got something she wants to tell us.
Thank you. I just wanted to update you on the Williamson County Homeless Alliance. These are notes from Kevin Riggs that I wanted to share with you in case you didn't see this on your internet, your Facebook. So I will check my notes to be sure I don't leave anything out. But beginning this last Friday night, the 12th, we will shelter the churches in Williamson County, and the Homeless Alliance will be sheltering homeless people for 12 nights in a row. And that's the second longest span of time. There was another year that we Williamson County Homeless Alliance and Friends sheltered homeless people for 16 days in a row. So I just want to make this you aware that because of the length of time and the many homeless people, there's such a huge need, as you can imagine. And Kevin Riggs, who is the director, asked us to please keep the staff, all the staff at different churches and at the Homeless Alliance, in our prayers. That's a long span of them to be responsible and trying to be helpful to people that need the help. We want to pray for the homeless. So many will not come into a shelter, and they are sleeping in their cars or on a doorstep. So just put those people in our prayers this next 12 days especially. I have the address for the Homeless Alliance and for the Community Center if you'd like those. I'm not going to announce them, but I have the addresses. At the Homeless Alliance offices, they have people that stay there during the day because they have laundry facilities, showers, computers to look for work, and they're caseworkers. But every night, the Community Center, Samantha Shepherd and her helpers, and there's a meal train group that will feed the homeless every day that they're sheltered in different churches. So that's 233 Natchez Street. I just wanted you to realize that Williamson County spent a lot of money on our new animal shelter, which I love animals, but we don't have a shelter for our homeless people. We really need to talk to our aldermen, our leaders in the government when and before there are elections to put this on their agenda. We must have a shelter. I wanted to tell you that right here at our church, we really need some warm coats, women's and men's. If you have a warm coat at your house that's in the back of the closet that you're not wearing anymore for whatever reason, think about bringing it to the church the days that Judy is here, or if you have a key to come in, or you can call me. But we need to put them upstairs where our homeless people spend the night on Friday nights. We have pretty many gloves, hats, and socks, but we need warm coats. There's some coats and sweaters hanging up there, but they're not warm enough, and to layer them is a problem for the homeless people because then they have to carry different things, too many things. So it's not an easy fix for them. So those are my messages for this morning. Thank you.
Pam, are there things coming in with children?
Not usually. We can ask Robert about that. There, every now and then we have one, but Robert knows the answer.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name's Jason White. I'm one of your elders and also the committee chair for the communications committee. So we want to make sure that we're fulfilling our promise to you guys. Every Sunday after we have a session meeting, the Sunday following, we want to give you an update on where we're at with the pastor nominating, okay? So this one's a big one. We want to make sure that you guys know that in 2 Sundays, we're going to have yet another congregational meeting after church. And this particular one will be to elect the pastor nominating committee. So it is up to you guys over the next 2 weeks to start approaching people, start thinking about where you feel like you might be able to give your feedback and your input. And if maybe that is strong enough that you would want to be also on the nominating committee. So, quick summary about the meeting in 2 weeks. There will be a congregational meeting directly following worship service on Sunday, January 28th, to elect the pastor nominating committee. The session has agreed that the committee will be comprised of up to 7 members. Members of the congregation are eligible to nominate qualified people to serve on the committee. Please be sure the person you are nominating is willing to serve on the committee. We don't want any surprises on the day that we're nominating people and they don't know that they're getting picked. Not cool, not cool. It is also possible to nominate yourself. There are handouts at all of the sanctuary entrances that give information on the qualifications and responsibilities for those serving on this committee. So, please be sure, if you have any questions, ask a responsible member of your session. Otherwise, be thinking about who you might like to nominate and whether that person might actually be you. Nothing wrong with that. That's it. Thanks, guys.
All right. In addition to those important announcements, we have a number of things going on in the church this week. Monday at 7 p.m., there's Bible study. Tuesday at 10 a.m., there's book club and children's story time, although that may be something we want to look at just based on the weather, unless we want a bunch of icicles outside that we're reading to. Worship committees at 5 p.m. Wednesday, there's Bible study at 10 a.m., and bell choir practice at 6 p.m. Saturday is the member care committee. And Sunday, we'll be back again for worship. All right, let's see. I was going to introduce our friend in the pulpit today by saying that this is somebody who goes, you know, who needs no introduction, but he insisted I say this. Steve's a former NFL player, still in the concussion protocol. He's a long-standing member of this church, an elder, wife to Tanya, father to Lily, Grace, and Sam, and he's joining us today on the pulpit. Okay, I'll move right from that to joys and concerns. Let's start with joys. Are there any joys you'd like to share with us today? Yes, sir.
My grandmother's turning, she's 94 today.
94, wow.
She's
cold. Yeah, so make her warm up.
What'd you say?
Is she in a warm
blood?
Yes.
Yes.
Today's
Pine Ward's
birthday.
Concerns?
I have one small concern. My oldest daughter is headed back to Iowa City today. So keep her in your prayers. We're fully expecting to have to put her in a hotel about Hannibal, Illinois, and do the rest of it tomorrow. But, you know, it's a bit of a mess up there. Even they think so. But last semester.
If you join me, please, in prayer. Dear God, I pray all that is on my heart to you this day. You are here, O Lord. Let us hold all these people in our hearts.
Listen to the prelude and worship God.
Good morning. Would you please stand as you are able for our call to worship? Where can we go from God's Spirit? If we ascend to heaven, God is there. If we make our bed in Sheol, God is there. If we take the wings of morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there, God's hand shall lead us, and God's right hand will hold us fast. Please turn page 159 in your Glory to God hymnal, and we will sing, Oh, Sing a Song of Bethlehem.
Shepherds watching there.
Please be seated. Let us approach God with confidence, trusting in God's grace as we humbly confess our sins together. Gracious God, you know us better than we know ourselves. You know our sins even before we confess. Your knowledge is wonderful, but also challenging. We'd much rather avoid painful truths and deny our role in wrongdoing. Help us to face our failings so we can move forward in truth. Amen. As the psalmist tells us, the steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. Friends, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. As God has forgiven us in Christ, let us offer the peace of Christ to one another. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Please share the peace with those around you.
Good morning. I'm reading from Psalm 139, verses 1 through 6 and 13 through 18, can be found in your Pew Bible in the Old Testament, page 577. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all of my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, and it is so high that I cannot attain it. For it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, and I know that very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes beheld my unformed substance. In your book was written all the days that were formed for me, but none of them as yet existed. How weighty to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. I try to count them, but they are more than the sand. I come to the end, and I am still with you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Michael came up to me and said we had a couple of announcements that we missed, so I'm going to read those now before we move on with the rest of the service. This is important. We have a progressive dinner coming up. The sign-up's out in Memorial Hall. It's going to be on Saturday, February the 10th at 5 p.m. And also, a week from today, there are going to be some folks going to lunch right after the service at O'Charley's on Murfreesboro Road, so we certainly hope that y'all would want to be part of that. And Robert has an announcement. Great. Anybody else want to say something before we move on with the service? Anything at all? Yes, Susan. Did you hear that? Did you say your son-in-law's sister is having a kidney transplant? So let's keep her in our prayers. Our next scripture lesson this morning comes from the Gospel of John in the first chapter. You can find it on page 92 in the New Testament portion of your pew Bible. This chapter in John is where all of the disciples are called. So we'll pick up on verse 43. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph, from Nazareth." Nathanael said to Philip, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Well, come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of Nathanael, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." This is the word of the Lord. My folks love to tell the story of my first experience sliding down a slide when I was a toddler. This was a slide at a playground in the 1960s. So this was one of those tall, straight, metal slides that many of you will remember. I was scared to try it. So my dad put me at the top of the slide, and in order to calm me down, He held onto the back of my shirt, and he said, "I've got you," and proceeded to run down the length of the slide beside me, holding my shirt the whole time, which apparently I thought was great fun. So I wanted him to do it again and again. After a while, Dad grew tired of this approach, and the next time I called out, "Hold my shirt," Dad, without missing a beat, replied, "You're okay. Here, you hold the back of your shirt." So I thought that seemed logical. So I reached back, grabbed the back of my own shirt, and slid happily down on my own, over and over. Now, despite what that may say about my mental capacity, what I remember most from that story, and from when I learned to ride a bike, and other times that I was afraid, was my dad or my mom saying, "I've got you." And the fact that I can remember that, and I bet each of you can remember similar experiences in your life, sets the stage for today's sermon titled Emmanuel. What comes to mind when you hear the word Emmanuel, be it spelled with an I, translated from Hebrew, or with an E, translated from Greek? When I hear the word Emmanuel, I think of Christmas. And I hear, "O come, Emmanuel." And I bet we think of this verse from Matthew. "Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," which means God with us. This is a beautiful scripture, and yet one of the challenges of deep traditions like Christmas is that we can leave it at Christmas, and we don't stop to discern what does Emmanuel mean to us during the other 364 days of the year. Emmanuel, God with us. What can we discern about this today? Our two scripture readings from the lectionary today give us a clue. Psalm 139, which Deborah read from this morning, is one of the most beautiful psalms. And it's been a great comfort to me, and I'm sure many of us, during trials of life. "You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all of my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in behind and before and lay your hand upon me." Or how about this part? "For it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made." Being known and loved from the very beginning, and particularly in dark valleys, being protected and held close. "I know you. I love you. I've got you." In our reading from John chapter 1, we hear the story of Philip and Nathanael becoming disciples of Jesus. Nathanael's famous put down when Philip is encouraging him to meet Jesus, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" demonstrates Nathanael's skepticism, born out of the dark nights of his soul under the fig tree. Then Jesus approaches Nathanael, picture this scene, and greets him like a long-lost friend, referencing things he shouldn't have known. And Nathanael, confused, says, "How do you know this?" And Jesus replied, "When you were in your lowest moment, under the fig tree, and you were alone. I saw you, and I did not turn my face from you. In other words, I know you and have always been with you. I've got you. Emmanuel. It's time for another story. Mary Stevenson was born in 1922 in Chester, Pennsylvania, outside of Philadelphia. She had many sisters and brothers, and her difficult life became even more difficult after her mother died when Mary was 6 years old. This forced her father to raise all 8 children by himself in the midst of the Great Depression. Mary then found herself in an abusive marriage at age 16. She became a teen mother and subsequently fled with her baby to an Indian reservation for safety. Mary had one thing she could draw on. She wrote poetry. And when she was 17, she wrote what occurs to me now was a psalm of her own. Some of you may find it familiar. One night, I dreamed I was walking along the beach with the Lord. Many scenes from my life flashed across the sky. In each scene, I noticed footprints in the sand. Sometimes there were 2 sets of footprints. Other times, there was 1 set of footprints. This bothered me because I noticed that during the low periods of my life when I was suffering from anguish, sorrow, defeat, I could only see 1 set of footprints. So I said to the Lord, "You promised me, Lord, that if I followed you, you would walk with me always. But I have noticed that during the most trying periods of my life, there have only been 1 set of footprints in the sand. Why, when I needed you most, have you not been there for me?" The Lord replied, "The times when you have seen only 1 set of footprints is when I carried you." Emmanuel, God with us. If we left things right here, that would indeed be wonderful. Emmanuel as a protection, Emmanuel as a support, Emmanuel as a comfort, our whole life long. However, Emmanuel has one more aspect that shines so bright it can change the world. Emmanuel as an example, as a model for us. Jesus, God with us, lived a life of radical union with the Father. Jesus, God with us, who after eating supper with his disciples, put on a servant's towel and washed the feet of Simon. Jesus, God with us, who said, and I quote, "If I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you owe it to wash one another's feet. For I have given you this as an example, so that you should do what I have done for you." Later on, in that same chapter of John, Jesus states it again emphatically. "I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another." Or to put it into the context of Emmanuel, Just as I am always with you, so also should you be there for one another. And it's that unbelievable, comforting, and life-changing commandment that is the Emmanuel call to be there for one another, to support one another, to ease one another's burdens. And lest we feel that we are inadequate to this call, I want you to listen to the words that Jesus spoke to his disciples on the eve of his betrayal. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you and in you. The truth of Emmanuel is here and now and forever past and forever future. Emmanuel, God with us. Emmanuel, God in us. Amen. Would you please stand? We're going to sing a hymn, Sing of God Made Manifest, number 156 in your hymn book. Please remain standing and let's join together with our affirmation of faith using words from a brief statement of faith printed in your bulletin. We trust in God, whom Jesus called Abba Father. In sovereign love, God created the world good and makes equally in God's image, male and female of every race and people, to live as one community. But we rebel against God. We hide from our Creator, ignoring God's commandments. We violate the image of God in others and ourselves, accept lies as truth, exploit neighbor and nature, and threaten death to the planet entrusted to our care. We deserve God's condemnation, yet God acts with justice and mercy to redeem creation. In everlasting love, the God of Abraham and Sarah chose a covenant people to bless all families of the earth. Hearing their cry, God delivered the children of Israel from the house of bondage. Loving us still, God makes us heirs with Christ of the covenant. Like a mother who will not forsake her nursing child, like a father who runs to welcome the prodigal home, God is faithful still. Please be seated. Let's turn to God in prayer this morning. Eternal God, just as you called Samuel and the prophets of old, you call us to lives of love and justice, breaking down barriers that divide, building bridges, cooperation, peace, and beloved community. As we remember the legacy of Martin Luther King Jr., we pray for the day when all God's children can be free. We pray for the day your children will not be judged by the color of their skin, but the content of their character. We pray for the day when hate and violence and bigotry are overpowered by love and peace and acceptance. Let justice roll down like waters, holy God, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. Holy God, hear the prayers of your people. As global wars rage and gun violence desecrates, protect the innocent and help us prioritize efforts of peace in the face of political polarization. Help us to listen more, seek understanding, and approach those with whom we disagree with humility and openness. Help us listen for the story beneath others' stories. In the face of fear and anxiety and pressures and provocation, help us to find in you a refuge and strength, a steadfast support in times of trial. Remind us, holy God, that we are not alone. Bless those who are suffering, ill, and grieving. United as the body of Christ, we lift these prayers to you, Savior God. Hear us now as we pray the prayer Christ taught us by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I ask that our ushers come forward so that we may receive our tithes and offerings this morning. Let us pray. Holy God, these offerings are only a portion of all that you've given us. We gratefully present these gifts and entrust them to your work in this world. May our gifts share the good news of the gospel to those who are in need. Amen. And before we do our last hymn, I just felt led to say we are so blessed with our choir and our instrumentalists. Thank you so much. If you would turn to hymn number 688, our final hymn is Spirit of God. May we leave this house of worship emboldened by the Spirit, redeemed by God's grace, and ready to follow Christ's call. May the grace, hope, peace, and love of the God, the Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer be with us now and always. Amen.